suggest I'm up here to take your photograph for a track and trace. So we'll do that first. That's great. Now, thank you. And since I'm up here, I'm going to welcome Reverend Alan Wilson this morning. I don't normally do that during COVID, but since I'm up here anyway. And one other thing I want to just mention, we have no internet this morning, so if you hear of anybody that can't get the live service, we don't know why that is, but it will be up as of tomorrow. We'll take a recording and put it on the internet, but we have no internet connection this morning, so at the minute anyway, we're not going out live. Okay. Welcome, Alan.
Stanley, for your warm welcome. It is really good to be with you again here in Second Sinfield. I was with you last Sunday. A week flies by so quickly, doesn't it? It really does. But I'm delighted to be with you again here, and hopefully with the problems we've encountered online, that the service may be recorded. And you'll be able to see that or hear the service at a later date for those who are not out this morning. But can I always encourage you that I know that with the strange times that we live in, and with our online services and the like, they are very, very good, but it's not the same as having fellowship one with one within the church building. It really isn't. And it's lovely whenever the people of God come together in one place that they can meet and share and have fellowship, albeit it's limited a little bit at the moment. Hopefully things will change and we'll get back to normal very, very soon. But can I encourage people to begin to come back to church? We want to see you. We really want to see you. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-stringed lyre and the melody of the harp. I don't think we have the harp or the lyre this morning. I'm sure they would sound lovely, but we have Ken on the piano who's going to keep us right, and we're going to sing together All I Once Held Dear.
Built my life upon all this world.
To come to God in prayer. Let's pray together. Sovereign God, we come into your presence reminded of your greatness, your holiness, and faithfulness. We are conscious that we come into the presence of one vastly greater than ourselves, the creator and sustainer of the universe and the author and perfecter of our faith. You are a God of justice and truth, mercy and love, the covenant God whose love and faithfulness is known by every generation, and your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures forever. We want to lift our praise to you and acknowledge that you are faithful to all your promises. Not a promise nor a word spoken by you has been broken or is impure. You are the God who came to us full of grace and truth and told us, "I tell you the truth." We thank you that you speak to us through your word and through the priests and prophets and judges and rulers and disciples and apostles, you offer insight into your sovereign purpose. And we are able to look to you for that direction and purpose in our lives, knowing that day by day we can rely upon you completely. You never let us down. Forgive us, Lord, for turning aside from you and making our own way. Forgive us for a harsh and critical spirit and for hearts that remain cold and unyielding, often refusing to forgive and reluctant to accept your will. Help us, Lord, to be honest with ourselves and with you as we seek to follow you. Forgive our foolish ways, our selfish manner. And in all the stress and rush of life, it is easy to lose our way. Our thoughts are turned in on ourselves rather than towards you. Correct us and speak to us that we may put you at the center of our lives. Teach us to focus on what really is important in our lives and to live effectively for you. Grant us your strength and courage to live out our lives in faith and to be prepared to take risks for you. For when we are going forward for you, it is then that your power and grace enables us. And so, Father, we ask that you would hear our prayers and petitions through Jesus, who taught us to say together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Now, before we read the words of affirmation, let's pause for a moment or two and consider the value to our souls of what exactly we are reading. What are the benefits of reading and understanding God's word? There are benefits. There has to be benefits for us. Benefits that are designed to help us to live our lives effectively under God. The psalmist tells us God's commandments make us wise. being wise is a very important thing in today's world. A lot wiser than people who set out to harm us. We have more understanding than people who consider themselves to be very intelligent. Older people are considered to be wise, but if we keep God's commands, we have even more understanding about life than they have. Keeping God's word helps us overcome temptation and thus avoiding falling into sin. When we are taught by God, we have the determination to obey God's rules. And through our understanding, we are better able to discern ways that are false and counterfeit and take us away from God. Jesus himself said about this world, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." So as well as bread and the sustenance that we need, the material sustenance, we also need the word of God. Honey has a lovely taste, but the Bible is sweeter than honey to those who love it, learn it, and live it. Can I invite you now to read the words printed in bold? "Oh, how I love your law. It is my meditation all the day. Your commandment makes me wiser than my enemies, for it is ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the aged, for I keep your precepts. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. I do not turn aside from your rules, for you have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through your precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way." Amen. We're going to sing once again another lovely hymn, "How Lovely Is Thy Dwelling Place."
Sparrow, fly.
Going to turn to God's Word now as we read together from the New Testament, from Matthew chapter 13. I'm going to read some verses from Matthew 13. So can I encourage you, if you have a Bible or it's on your phone, please follow along. In this chapter and throughout Matthew in particular, Jesus speaks a lot about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. He talks a lot about what actually it's like. When people first heard him talk about the kingdom, they weren't sure what he meant. So Jesus is at pains to tell us what actually this kingdom is about. So we read together from verse 24. He put another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed seeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' So the servants said to him, 'Then do you want us to go and gather them?' But he said, 'No, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" And then we read from verse 36, where this parable is explained. "Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples came to him, saying, 'Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field.' He answered, 'The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. And just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear.'" Amen. And we thank God for the reading of his word. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we ask for discernment. We ask for enlightenment to your word and to what you're saying to us. Lord, help us indeed to hear, to be doers of your word, and to obey. We pray this in your name. Amen. The TV program Fake Britain sometimes on in the morning. It's quite interesting to watch. And the program is about criminals in Britain who sell things to people like you and me that are not real. They are fake. It used to be that police would have raided Sunday markets like the one at Nuts Corner in Belfast a number of years ago. I don't know if the one in Nuts Corner is still operating. It's a long time since I was there. And the police would have gone up there where dodgy traders were selling off videos and cameras and watches and cigarettes and the like. All the stuff was really counterfeit or fake. And Del Boy, there's a picture of him there, he would have been in his element back then. Today there is hardly any household item that cannot be replicated as a fake. Even the new £5 notes have had to have special holograms printed on them, something that the criminals have not mastered yet. No doubt they will. Everything from Christmas tree lights to perfume to watches, trainers, even food can be sold as counterfeit. Everything, it seems, can be a fake, including people and churches who claim to follow Jesus. Both are identical. In other words, there is hardly anything on the surface that separates counterfeit Christians from true Christians who have saving faith. They both look identical, which can be very perplexing and confusing for people. In the parable of the wheat and the tares, or the wheat and the weeds, this is what Jesus is at pains to talk about. The tare is a type of weed. And gardeners know how destructive and damaging weeds can be. They can get out of control very, very quickly. And Jesus was brought up in the countryside, and he liked telling parables about the countryside. He saw different things going on in the countryside and the natural world. And after all, he was the one that created it all. So the meaning of this parable is hard-hitting, and it should jolt people from their apathy. We need to understand that when the farmer sows the field with wheat, almost immediately weeds start to grow up alongside the tender shoots. These weeds are called darnel. And this weed called darnel and wheat look very alike, almost identical, and you can see them there. In real life, you would find it very, very difficult to distinguish them. You cannot tell them apart. Darnel actually looks nourishing, but is actually quite poisonous, and it can even cause death. Thankfully, though, this is a parable that is easy for us to figure out because Jesus tells us what the parable means, so we're not left confused or bewildered. However, the meaning of the parable stumped the disciples, so he tells them and he tells us what actually this parable means. The one who sows the good seed is Jesus. The field is the world. The good seeds are Jesus' true followers, the true Christians. The weeds or the tares are the sons of the devil. And the one who sows the weed, the enemy, is the devil. God does not sow the weeds. He sows the good seeds. Then comes the harvest, and the harvesters are the angels. It's a straightforward parable, but there are a few puzzling things that will trouble us, or should trouble us. Number one, the devil has a very large family, and his family are made up of counterfeits. In other words, they are imitators of the true faith. Now, the first imitator of faith was Cain, who was the son of Adam and Eve. In the book of Genesis, we are told he had a brother called Abel, and both men were religious. So both Cain and Abel were religious people. What did Cain do? Well, he killed his own brother because he was jealous of his brother's relationship with God. Then when God asked Cain, "Where is your brother?" Cain lied by saying, "I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper?" Cain was a member of the devil's family. And if you go on and read about some of the despicable kings of Judah and Israel and the various tribes of the Middle East, you will find also that they are family members. The devil has sadly a very large global family. The New Testament, which gets much closer to the truth, in that we discovered who belongs to the devil's family. Well, it's the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees and people of that ilk. Now, you may think, well, they are just good. Well, they're a wee bit misguided, but well-intentioned people, but not according to Jesus. Jesus susses them out right away. He knows exactly where they stand with him. The Pharisees and scribes are the ruling religious leaders and had been around for hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus walked on this earth. What did they think of Jesus? That's a good question. What did these religious leaders, who were actually leading and guiding the people, what did they actually think of the Messiah who was standing in front of them? Well, after Jesus healed a demon-possessed man, they said, "It is only by the devil, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons. It is only through the devil that he does that." Not really what you would call uplifting or encouraging words for Jesus. Jesus knew exactly where the Pharisees and the scribes stood. He called them a brood of vipers several times, and vipers are poisonous snakes and can be very deadly. And after a relentless war of words the Pharisees had waged against Jesus throughout his ministry, right throughout his ministry, they kept this barrage of bitterness and hatred against Jesus throughout. Jesus says this about them in Matthew 23. "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You travel over land and sea to win a single convert, and when he becomes one, you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are." It's pretty strong stuff. It's certainly not PC. Jesus doesn't mince his words, and it's as well the Northern Ireland Equality Commission or Amnesty International weren't there to hear Jesus because the lawsuits would have been piled high against him. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He goes on to say, "You appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you're full of hypocrisy and wickedness." And we see another side of the gentle Jesus, meek and mild. And Jesus was not afraid of calling people out. He was the most courageous man who ever lived. Now, this is important to note. This is important. Nowhere does Jesus ever say that if you are not a child of God, you are a child of the devil. He never says that. The only people he says that about are the religious leaders, the Pharisees and company. And it says a lot, sadly, about religious leaders. Jesus knows where each person on this planet stands with him. All 7 billion plus people, he knows exactly where everybody stands with him. He knows those who have rejected him, and he knows those who have accepted him. In other words, you can't bluff Jesus. These people are members of Satan's family, and they do his bidding for him. And the devil comes to us, the Bible says, as an angel of light, always hiding his true intentions, because the devil is extremely deceitful. Extremely. He's the father of lies. You see, the Pharisees appeared to others as very religious people who prayed, who tithed, who carried the scriptures around with them. They looked the real deal, and many rabbis still do to this day, and so do many others who give the impression they are followers of Jesus. In fact, you can't tell apart if they're a true believer. I remember a few years ago I was involved in a mission over in Manchester with a Jewish group called Jews for Jesus. I don't know if you've ever heard of them. And we were distributing leaflets in Manchester city centre. And interestingly, the majority of people who actually stopped and stood and chatted with us were young Muslim women and a number of Muslim men. Sadly, the local Mancunian rarely took us under their notice. But we were all wearing high visibility jackets, yellow and orange, and we had the large print words on the jacket, Jews for Jesus, so us people knew exactly what we were about. The second highest population of Jews outside London live in Manchester. But when the Orthodox rabbi walked by, we were met with derision and disgust, and some members, not myself, but some members were actually spat upon by the Orthodox rabbis. It's really very, very sad, but actually quite biblical. And that was the first time, I think, in my life where people had actually openly objected to my presence, to our presence as Christians. I have to say, it is not a nice feeling. And I don't know if anybody here this morning has ever had an experience where actually you're spat upon or ridiculed for your faith. It's not nice. And yet that is what Jesus was subjected, and in fact, much worse throughout his life. Now, I'm just talking about the Pharisees and rabbis. I'm just using them as an example. There are scores and scores of others who are similar to them today. But that's the first point. The devil is real. He exists, and he has a religious family who look, speak, and act like the real thing. And you can see why this parable isn't preached very often. I think I have only ever heard this parable preached once. And the second point is this. Jesus, in this parable, is not dealing with the problem of evil in the world. This parable is not about evil creeping into the world. Jesus is dealing with a specific truth, namely, that wherever God plants a true child of God, the devil comes along and plants a counterfeit who looks like the real deal. And it's a fact. It is a fact. The devil is a neighbor, whether we like that or not. He is in our neighborhood. Jesus is the sower and owner of the field. The earth belongs to God, and the devil is a trespasser. It is not his world. And the scary thing for us is that he acts as if it is his. And sometimes when we see the evil constantly around us, we tend to believe this. But it will never be the devil's world, and the devil knows this. And knowing this, he causes dissension and strife and wars and rumors of wars and chaos, and he plants counterfeits. The servants wake up one day to find weeds growing in the field alongside the good seed. Note, while they were sleeping, the enemy came. And Christians need to be very alert and awake to what is going on in the world. The devil planted the seeds while they were asleep. Immediately they ask, where did the weeds come from? An enemy did this, replies Jesus. And the natural response is, the servants ask him, do you want us to go and pull them up? And Jesus says, no, don't. Because while you are pulling the weeds up, you may root up the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest at the end of the age. What? You must be joking, Jesus. Surely you pull the weeds up right away. Surely you pull these counterfeits up right away, these distorters of the truth. You get rid of them, don't you? Well, the fact is, strange as it may seem, Jesus is not worried about the weeds. He really isn't. We are more worried about the weeds, who are the distorters and the suppressors of the truth. Personally, I have to say, I get saddened, I even get worried about various fashionable culture trends and the watering down and the distorting of the gospel that is infiltrating mainstream church and being endorsed by religious leaders. And it's been going on for quite a while. Religious leaders trying to be cool or trendy, thinking that somehow the devil's schemes will actually benefit the church to be more inclusive and boost the numbers and somehow avoid criticism. But interestingly, Jesus or the Apostle Paul, they never ever thought like that. Both were criticized throughout their entire ministries. There will be a harvest, and it is going to come at the end of the age. God will tell the angels, not us, to gather up the weeds, the counterfeit Christians, and all who do evil, where they will be thrown into the fiery furnace. In other words, there will be a time of judgment by God when the true fruits of one's labors will become clear, and no one will be able to bluff God. We will not be able to stand before God and say it was his fault or it was her fault. God will gather the wheat, who are the true believers, and they shall be brought into the kingdom. Two very, very different outcomes for all people, for every occupant on this planet. One person who was a counterfeit, yet he followed Jesus in a very public way, was Judas Iscariot. He's a very, very interesting character, actually. And we can learn a little from his life. And the life of Judas reminds us that it is possible to be near Christ and associate with him closely, albeit superficially, and yet become utterly hardened to sin.
Also, Judas reminds us that no matter how sinful a person may be, no matter what treachery he or she may attempt against God, the purpose of God can never, ever be stopped. God's sovereign plan cannot be overthrown by the most cunning schemes or by those who hate him. His plans can never be thwarted, thank God. Well, what do we know about Judas? Well, Judas was handpicked by Jesus to be one of his disciples. He was actually handpicked. He was specially chosen by Jesus. And after 3 years, he walked with Jesus publicly for 3 years among the towns and villages and the synagogues of Galilee. He was given a position of authority within the group of disciples looking after the money, a bit like the church treasurer. He saw the miracles Jesus performed, the healings, the calming of the storm, the feeding of the 5,000 and a host of others. He listened to the sermons Jesus preached. He even stayed with Jesus right to the end when less devoted disciples began leaving the group, claiming that Jesus' teaching was too difficult. So other disciples actually left the group, but Judas stayed on. And it is very significant that when Jesus predicted one of the disciples would betray him, none of the others was able to point the finger of suspicion at Judas. So good was Judas at keeping his true self a secret. Judas had given his life to following Jesus, but he had never given his heart to Jesus. And there are countless and countless examples like Judas throughout the course of history where people have acted, spoken, and behaved in a way that convinces those around them, but actually nothing could be farther from the truth. And although Judas could see clearly that Jesus had authority and power that no other human being possessed, he was not attracted to Christ on a spiritual level. He followed Jesus out of a desire of selfish gain, prestige, and greed, and he sensed Jesus' power, and he wanted some of that power and prestige for himself. I remember a few years ago talking to one of the professors at Union College, and we were talking about spiritual gifts. And he said to me something that I never forgot. He said that when I see the sickness and disease in the world, I would have loved God to have given me the gift of healing where I could have laid hands on people and healed them. But then again, he said, I'm glad he didn't do that because it would have filled me up with my own sense of pride and self-importance. Very unlike Judas. Judas was not interested in the kingdom of God. He was only interested in what he could get out of it and how it would further him. Judas was never drawn to the person of Christ. He might have been curious about him, but that's actually as far as it goes. He never embraced Jesus' teaching of placing our faith in him. He never really had a true love for Jesus. In fact, the longer he was with Jesus and the more sermons he heard, the more his heart hardened against him. He never truly repented of his sin and believed. It's amazing how someone can be that close to Jesus Christ, to have heard those number of sermons and seen the miracles and the wonderful things that Jesus did, and yet his heart was still hardened. Quite amazing. And Judas's life, aspects of his life, his attitude, are something that we certainly need to be mindful of. The older we get, the more complacent and more hardened we become into thinking that we have done all right so far in life without having to submit to God. We think that when the day comes or when we die, we'll be all right. God will look after us. So why do I need now to take Christ seriously and give my life to him? Well, because a day will come in your life when you will be judged by God, who incidentally has the sole authority to do that. And when that happens, it will be too late for you to change your mind because you will have already been condemned. And those who belong to Christ and he knows who they are will have eternal life in heaven, and those who have rejected Christ and what he did for them will be thrown into hell. And this is a sobering reality as outlined by Jesus. And what Jesus says will come to be. And all I am doing, I am just merely retelling what Jesus told the disciples. But why do you think Jesus does not pull up the weeds now? Why is he waiting and waiting and waiting? Well, the time isn't right. But also, it's because Christians have a job to do living and working among the weeds. We have work to do for the kingdom of God. And that's why he doesn't pull us up and send us directly into heaven. We are to be active in the things that matter to God and not to be apathetic or indifferent as we live out our lives. We are to reach counterfeits with the good news of the gospel. In his love and through his mercy, God gives the weeds time to repent and believe. Some may do it, and some may not. But it shows us that even with counterfeits, God in his grace and in his love and compassion grants them a chance to turn from their ways right up to the harvest, which will come at the end of the age. What an amazing God. True Christian believers are to grow strong and firm in faith where many around you are as counterfeits. And this is a time that can be very hard going, especially when we face obstacles, our setbacks, or criticisms along the way, especially from a spiritual, hostile, and intolerant society, even from members of our own family, as Jesus himself experienced. But please remember, the one who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for people like Martin Luther and John Calvin and others who have influenced your church for the good down through the generations. Bible teachers, communicators, translators, Christian authors, church leaders, composers, artists, reformers. We pray for people in these fields of influence today. For hymn writers, ministers, musicians, singers, Sunday school teachers and youth leaders, theologians who write and communicate the good news. We pray for those who teach in theological colleges. Lord, may you grant them guidance, vision, and a close walk with you in order to discern your will for their work. We pray for the Reverend David Leach, who takes up his new position as Professor of Ministry at Union College. We pray for him, his wife and family, and the work that lies ahead. Lord, We pray for churches and fellowships to experience a tangible moving of your Spirit, drawing people to a genuine walk with you. The world is a dark place that needs the light of your Spirit. Grant that your warmth, peace, and presence and challenge be evident in Christian gatherings across the world. We pray too for the Christian Coptic Church in Egypt that has suffered much through bombings and assassinations. Lord, our hearts go out to those members. And may Christians and churches be protected by the state and be allowed to worship you freely without fear of attack. May the rights of Christians be upheld by the police and courts, and help leaders and pastors to be wise in what they say and do. And we pray for the Christian Broadcasting Unit, SAT-7, and other units like them, which operates in the Middle East and North Africa, asking that your word that goes out from my mouth will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire. May this indeed be so. And we pray too for the minister of this church, the Reverend John and his family, asking for protection for them, for safety and travel, and for courage for John and rest. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn is How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And we'll once again stand together and sing.
Should I gain from his reward?
just thank everybody for taking part in the service. It's great to have you with us as a congregation, and for the tech team and our singers, and for Ken, for everybody involved. Thank you. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day. Amen.
Oh,